Hi everyone, Siti Hajar and myself, Ria Aka Devan, are presenting a personality analysis on a movie based on a true story called Girl Interrupted. Susanna Kaysen. The protagonist was an 18-year-old diagnosed with borderline personality disorder in 1967. She spent 18 months at Claymore Psychiatric Institution after attempting suicide. Her psychiatrist's notes reveal she is highly intelligent but completely in denial of her condition. She is very creative and aspires to be a writer. Susanna was struggling with an unstable sense of self and dysfunctional interpersonal relationships. Adolescence is a tricky period for most teens, where they are trying to find out who they are and their place in the world. Susanna's narcissistic parents never gave any importance to her thoughts, and she was not allowed to speak her mind. In her words, she said, "I dare not fight back." She was finding it difficult to identify her real self. In a weak moment, she consumed a full bottle of aspirin with vodka. She would have angry outbursts during extremely stressful moments.
I think you need to get up.
I'm just gonna rest for a while, just a little while.
Hey!
Sorry, too cold.
What the fuck are you doing? Get me the fuck out of this tub!
Get yourself out.
This place is a fucking fascist torture chamber!
No. See, I worked in state hospitals. This place is a five-star hotel.
Oh, Lordy, pick a bit of something. Oh, Lordy.
You know, I can take a lot of crazy shit from a lot of crazy people, but you are not crazy.
What's wrong with me? Huh? What the fuck is going on inside my head?
You are a lazy, self-indulgent little girl who is driving herself crazy.
Is that your medical opinion? Huh? Is that what you've learned in your advanced studies at night school for Negro welfare mothers?
Susanna's parents' social life was a superficial image, and they paraded Susanna as a trophy offspring. But in reality, they seemed disappointed in her. Feelings of neglect and abandonment led to her low self-esteem. When Susanna was being sent to the mental institution, her parents avoided an emotional departure. Her father was not present, and her mother just sat in her own car while Susanna left alone in a cab. To feel needed, she indulged in promiscuity, which increased her self-esteem momentarily, only to crash, and she needed pleasure again. According to Carl Jung, psychic energy consists of opposites, and one must find a balance between these opposites for a personality to become whole. Susanna was clearly struggling to find herself as she constantly battled different points of view from within and outside. Her value systems often conflicted with those of her parents, teachers, and society at large. This caused an imbalance and made her unhappy. The type theory categorizes people on introversion and extroversion. Every individual has both attitudes, but one remains dominant. Susanna was an introvert. Although shy and a loner, she was friendly and loyal towards her peers at Claymore. Susanna has a dominant introverted sensing. She re-experiences the past like it were just happening. She compared every experience with stored memories in her mind. She makes decisions based on emotions. Susanna is also an introverted feeler. She is sensitive towards those in need of help. She is caring, nurturing, and has a high level of empathy. The picture shows her and her friend Lisa attempting to soothe an inmate having a breakdown by singing to her. Ego. Susanna was suffering from an identity crisis and had no clear ego. personal unconsciousness. Susanna was haunted by her unpleasant past that came to her consciousness every time she felt stressed. Collective unconsciousness. The persona. Susanna's mask was to help her fit in. Not being her real self caused conflict and was not allowing herself to grow. The anima or animus. Every time Susanna tried showing her animus by being assertive or thoughtful, the elders ridiculed her. Her teacher mocked her for not going to college and scoffed at her for wanting to be a writer. The self. Being an ambivalent, Susanna had contradictory feelings about herself. Karen Horney believed childhood experiences develop personality and neurosis develop from anxiety caused by interpersonal relationships. Susanna's anxiety was caused by her parents' domination and her sense of helplessness. Their lack of warmth and indifference triggered her desire for love and security to reduce her feelings of despair. Neurotic need for affection and approval. Fearing of hostility towards her, Susanna was compliant and submissive to avoid rejection and feelings of abandonment. Neurotic need to restrict one's life within narrow borders. Susanna preferred to remain unnoticed and often undervalued her own talents and abilities. Finally, neurotic need for self-sufficiency and independence. She distanced herself and preferred being a loner as she didn't want to be emotionally dependent on others. Susanna exhibited two of the three neurotic trends. Firstly, needs moving you towards others. Susanna sought affirmation from her friends, lovers, and family for approval and affection. Second, needs moving you away from others. In stressful moments, comparing her present to her past created hostility and antisocial behaviors in her. She would show aggression or remain detached. Susanna's coping styles became neurotic. Satisfying her needs helped her temporarily escape her anxiety. She felt her life was so painful, death seemed like a dream. Seeing the suicide of her inmate shook her. She decided to turn herself around. She wrote a journal, spoke her feelings out, and took to painting. She was finally released from the institution and she has moved on with her life.
Now I'll be talking about the antagonist, Lisa Rowe. Lisa is a 20-year-old Claymore Hospital patient. She's a charismatic, manipulative, and an abusive young girl who exploits people for her own amusement. Lisa does not appreciate medicines and psychotherapy. Lisa thinks she's hot shit because she's a sociopath. Sociopathy is also known as antisocial personality disorder. According to Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, Lisa displays several symptoms of APD, such as failure to conform to social norms with respect to lawful behaviors, as indicated by repeated performing acts that are ground for arrest. Lisa always escapes the hospital, but she always got herself arrested by the police and brought back, meaning she was doing something to get arrested. The second would be impulsivity or failure to plan ahead. Her impulsivity and lack of capability to plan ahead is highlighted with her escape to Florida with Susanna. The last would be lack of remorse, as indicated by being indifferent to or rationalizing having hurt, mistreated, or stolen from another. Now, Freud proposed that there are three structures of the mind, which is the ID or id. It is the pleasure principle, the unconscious and the primitive part of the mind. The second would be ego. Ego is about self-control. It weighs the pros and cons of behavior before acting on it. The last one would be superego. It's the moral compass, the guideline for judgment making. Lisa has high id and low ego. Lisa acts impulsively according to what she wants without thinking about the consequences. She also has a weak superego. She is pervasive when it comes to morality and authority figures and always rebel against them. Lisa also exhibits neurotic anxiety. This usually happens when there's a conflict between it and ego, the pleasure and reality. When she finds out that Susanna is actually having her treatments and are going to be let out soon, her fantasy is threatened. Maybe in her head, Susanna will stay forever in the mental institution with her, or maybe Lisa is jealous that Susanna is healing. She then proceeds to steal her diary, read it aloud amusingly for everyone, and intimidates Susanna. Lisa has several defense mechanisms that she uses to protect herself. The first would be projection. Projection is attribution of one's own disturbing impulse or quality to someone else. This usually happens as a result of a lack of insight or acknowledgement of one's own motive and feelings. And it's usually someone else that's causing the problem. It's not you, it's never you. In the movie, she screamed, "You weak fucking people, you're all victims." This could be an indication of what she felt about herself. In Lisa's head, that should not be the case. She's a sociopath. She can't be weak. Therefore, everyone around her should be weaker than her. While she was confronting Susanna at the end of the movie, she asked why is she so neglected. Susanna responded by saying because Lisa is already dead inside. Having someone finally tell her that she's the one who's weak all along is a slap in the face. This profoundly affects Lisa, who breaks down wailing, crying. The second would be rationalization, excusing unacceptable behaviors. Lisa justified that she did not cause Daisy to commit suicide, that she was waiting for an excuse to do so. She also called Daisy an idiot for killing herself.
Make it a hearse.
Daisy ran down. She killed herself. 23 Vickers Street. Yes, please hurry. Press your buttons. Now you're taking her.
Please, I didn't press shit. She was waiting for an excuse.
Come on, pack up. We have to go.
All right? We have to go. We have money. Susanna, don't be stupid. All right, fine. Be stupid.
The second theory that I'll be using is Alfred Adler's individual psychology. Adler believed that all humans have inferiority feeling, and people who did not overcome it would develop inferiority complex, while those who overcompensated would develop superiority complex. Lisa has superiority complex. As a sociopath, Lisa is self-centered, narcissistic, and arrogant. She is always at the top of the food chain by bullying and being in charge. She is capable of kindness, but will act aggressively when disobeyed or intimidated. Now, superiority complex differs from genuine confidence in that confidence is a result of having an actual skill, success. In contrast, a superiority complex is a false confidence, a facade with little achievement and success. In the movie, she also interacts with people just to get their attention when she's bored.
Meow. Meow. Hey, Torch. What you doing?
Nothing.
Well, why don't you go to your room and do nothing? Huh?
Ha ha ha. Margie.
Hey, Lisa.
What you doing? Checks. How's Joe?
He's fine.
Yeah.
Lisa, I have to do my checks.
Yeah, and what? Taking 5 minutes from me would be a dereliction of duty, huh? What if I had a punctured artery? What would you do? You just keep going about your rounds, ignore my wounds?
Lisa, stop it.
Stop what? You fucking peek. Look at this. Go ahead. Go ahead.
That's enough.
Take one fucking step and I'll jam this in my aorta. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Stop it.
Lisa, your aorta is in your chest.
Good to know.
The source for Lisa's superiority complex is that she was neglected as a child. She's been in the mental institution since she was 12 years old, and her parents wished she was dead. Neglected children are prone to have pent-up anger and inferiority. Lisa overcompensated hers. She chased away her own inferiority by making others feel smaller and weaker. Adler also said that we're all pushing ourselves towards perfection, fulfillment, and self-actualization, and we all use different styles of life in doing so. Lisa has a dominant style of life. She likes to be in charge of other patients. That's her idea of having, well, a perfect life. She has the tendency to be generally aggressive and dominant over others, possessing an intense energy that overwhelms anything or anyone who gets in her way. As a conclusion, before Susanna was released the next morning, she visited Lisa, who is now restrained to a bed, and they reconcile. In tears, Lisa told her that she's not really dead inside and she'll miss Susanna. The movie ends with Susanna getting in a taxi, going home as a recovered borderline. And that's the end. I hope you enjoyed the video and thank you for watching.